In this video, we're going to try to tackle a calculus optimization problem. So here's the problem. It's a very realistic problem. We're walking down a hallway that's 8 feet wide, and then we're going to try to make a turn into a hallway that's 27 feet wide. And the question is very simple. What's the length of the longest object that's able to make this turn? And obviously we're assuming horizontally without flipping it up on the end or anything like that. So if you were trying to move a couch or something around, what's the longest couch or pipe or whatever it is you're trying to make a turn with that would fit in this hallway and then make the turn to fit in the other hallway? It's kind of a long problem, so I've pre-done a lot of the algebra. I'm basically just going to walk us through what we do here. So first of all, I drew a picture. That's always important for these optimization problems, is the first thing we always need to do is draw a picture of the situation. So for this hallway, what I did was I made the x-axis one wall, and then for the y-axis, I made that another wall here. So I put points, and these turn out to be pretty nice points, being that I labeled these on the axes. The point on the left wall, I'll call that 0b, because I know the x-coordinate is 0, and so I only have to worry about what the y-coordinate is, or the y-intercept. So that's 0b. Now do note that b is going to be negative because of the orientation of the picture is below the x-axis, but that's cool. That's not going to pose any problems. And on the top side, the pipe or whatever will have to stretch, obviously until it hits the other wall if we're trying to maximize its length, and it'll hit at a point c, 27. So again, by my orientation here, this hallway is 27 feet tall, so any point along this upper wall right here will be something, 27. We just don't know what the x-coordinate is. Now, you could have other couches or pipes or whatever that fit in the hallway, you know, maybe something like this or like this or like that, but obviously those would not be maximized. I think it's pretty safe to assume that if we're going to maximize this length, it's got to go through the point here, 8, because this hallway is 8 feet wide, 8, 0. And if it hasn't, you can make it a little longer until it does touch. So this is going to be a constraint that needs to be met. All right, so let's get started with the algebra. The function that we're trying to minimize is the distance function. So what I start off by doing is take the distance between this point and this point. And depending on what B and C are, you can get long distances or short distances, and I have not incorporated the constraint yet. Now for this problem, I know the way the question was phrased was we were trying to find the maximum length pipe that could fit around the corner of a hallway here, but believe it or not, what we're actually going to try to do is minimize this distance subject to these constraints. Now what are the constraints? Well, a constraint would be it has to touch this wall, which means one of the points will be 0b. It has to touch this wall, so it'll touch c, 27, and it has to touch the corner right here of the hallway. So based off of those constraints, I'm actually looking for the shortest distance possible that still reaches from wall to wall. The reason I'm not going to actually look for the maximum distance is I could find a pipe length that would touch this wall, that would touch this wall, and that would reach all the way across and touch this wall, that would be way, way, way too long to actually fit around the corner. When you fit around the corner, you actually need it as small as possible temporarily to fit around that corner. Obviously, long lengths can fit around wide spaces, but only the smallest couch can fit even through the tightest corners here. So we're still getting the longest length possible, but what we mean is subject to these constraints of touching the two opposite walls as well as lightly touching this corner as it goes around. Now, unfortunately for this distance formula here, there's one problem with it that's present in all optimization problems, and that's the fact that this guy has too many variables. You can't differentiate and set equal to zero if there's not just one independent variable, and our distance is dependent on C and B. So here's where that constraint comes into play. The constraint that we're going to use is the fact that you have to go through this point 8, 0. Now, how are we going to express that mathematically? Well, one way to guarantee that we go through the point 8, 0 is to ensure that the slope between 0 and 0b to 80 matches the slope from 80 to C27. If those slopes are the same, then it has to go through the point 80 here. Now, I hope that's pretty clear why that would be the case. Just to try to show you a counterexample here, if you had your 0b right here, well, then the slope between that point and 80 would not be the same as the slope between 80 and C27. So obviously those would not be the same. But if we're going to assume just by common sense that the optimal length will actually go through this point 80, then it's safe to assume that this slope would match the entire slope here. So for our constraint, we'll have y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. So that'll be 0 minus b divided by 8 minus 0. That should match the slope between the outer two points, 27 minus b divided by c minus 0. 27 minus b divided by c minus 0. So I went ahead and fast forwarded through the algebra here. If you solve this for one of the variables in terms of the other, you would get this equation right here. Now, why do we do that with this example? Well, the same reason as we do it for every other optimization problem. You want to go back up to this formula right here that had too many variables, and we want to sub out one of these variables in terms of the other guy so that it'll be just one independent variable. So we're going to sub into the distance formula. So we're going to take that distance formula that we had, and again, I'm going to fast forward through the algebra or else this video would be an hour long. Sub in for C and it reduces to this. And there's only one independent variable. So good job. Now we are able to take derivatives and, you know, find maxes or mins or whatever it is we're after. So being that D is simply a function of B now, I'm going to take the derivative and set it equal to 0. So here's D prime. Again, I've fast forwarded that algebra. I set it equal to 0. And if you kind of follow with me here, I can kind of walk you through some of this. This is subtracted, so if you take this expression and add it to the right-hand side, this radical will be in the denominator, and you can multiply it right back to the left. So the square root that's squared will cancel. Along with it comes the 2b cubed, and is still negative because of that. On the right-hand side, you still have 128, that's from here, as well as 27 minus b, but it's not negative anymore because we added it to the right. All right, so this equation here simplifies. I did that here. I distributed negative 2b cubed through. You have a minus 128b and a minus 128b. You can cancel both of those. So negative 2b cubed equals 3,456. Divide by negative 2. So b cubed is negative 1728. And the cube root of negative 1728 is a nice, pretty negative 12. Awesome. Now, that's a critical number. That could be a maximum or it could be a minimum. From this problem, I think it's pretty clear that if you chose a b value anywhere other than negative 12, like negative 11 or negative 13, you would get a pipe or something that would be longer, right? That would be longer than our pipe. And so it might fit at that moment in time, but when you go a little bit farther, it's going to get stuck around the corner. We actually need somewhat of a shorter pipe length to fit even through the toughest spots. All right, so where are we? So there's our relative min right there. Okay, so here's an updated picture. I know that this is 0, negative 12. I know it goes through 80, and I need it to touch on the other side of the wall to C27. I'm going to go back to that formula that I had that related, that constraint that related B and C. And now that I know what B is, if you pop it back in, you get C is 26. That's a very reasonable answer, right? 26, 27, right? It's certainly well past 8 like we would expect. All right, so what the actual distance is the distance between 0, negative 12 and 26, 27. So you take y2 minus y1, that's 39 squared, and then x2 minus x1, that's 26, and we square that, and the distance is the square root of the sum of those two. You get 46.87 feet, about 49 feet, and just based off of the hallway and just thinking about our answer, That seems very in line with the types of numbers that we started with. It seems very reasonable here. What I also did was I drew on the TI here. This line here is y equals 27 right here. This vertical line right here is x equals 8. So you can kind of see the hallway. I know it's not super clear, but you can kind of see the hallway there. And sure enough, yeah, this fits absolutely perfectly. It comes in, touches the corner here, the hallway. So it looks like we're doing pretty well. Couple extra things just now that we're done. What's the equation of that line here where we can find these points? How do I know what to plug in the calculator? Well, you just need two things for the equation of a line. You need the y-intercept. Fortunately, we know that is negative 12. So that's one thing. And then you also need the slope. So what's the rise over run between these two points? Well, it would be 39 over 26. Okay, and then the last kind of interesting thing we might want to look for if we wanted to do that is at this trimmest place that, as you move this thing through and it's as tight as it's going to be before it frees up again, we might be curious what angle is made right here? What's this theta that gets made right here? Well, that's a pretty simple problem as well. Obviously, the hallway is 27 feet wide. Now, I know our x coordinate was 26, but let's not forget 8 of that was the other hallway. So if you take 26 minus 8, you get 18. And so this is a right triangle with an opposite edge of 27 and an adjacent edge of 18. So if we take tan theta, that's 27 over 18, that leads to a theta of about 56 degrees. So that's good to show you that if you were starting this problem, you might have anticipated the toughest point to get by would be 45 degrees, but that's not really the case. It's actually a little bit larger than that. Now, what causes that? Well, simply because one of the hallways is much wider than the other. So we would kind of expect, that type of answer. So anyways, hope that helps you understand how to work this problem a little bit better. This is kind of a tough one, but these practical problems are the best types to work.